today's lecture on image processing, retrieval and analysis. Let us begin by also briefly reminding ourselves what crucial insight we obtained last week. Here is a brief recap. Recall that we have been studying this crucial idea of a filtering. We have been studying the Fourier transform for a couple of sessions now. And last time we saw an interesting application of all of this. In particular, we had a look at the ideas of low, high, and band pass filtering. To get back into the spirit of this, let's look at the picture we had. So, for instance, for a one-dimensional function, which is a fancy way of saying that we're now looking at a function of just one variable or two, one-dimensional low-pass filter is something, let's call it G of Bonn-Aachen, is something, is a function defined in the frequency domain. So let us look at the frequency domain. So here are all the frequencies, omega along the x-axis. And let us assume that here is 1. And the low-pass filter we looked at last time is something that looks like this. Is a function, and it's supposed to be steeper here. And make it really jumpy. So good. Probably should use a different color to make it down. This is a low-pass filter where at a certain cutoff frequency, omega sub L, and negative is minus omega sub L, we find that this function is basically zero for almost all of the domain. And then in a certain frequency range, from minus omega sub L up to omega sub L, it is not zero, but 1. And we saw that we may multiply such a function with the frequency representation of whatever function we are actually interested in. And by means of that multiplication, so if we consider, I don't know, I'll make it, say, we have g of omega, and we multiply that with the Fourier transform of some function we are given, and all of this would produce a new function defined in the frequency domain, then of course this function h of omega will be zero everywhere outside of this frequency band, and it will be, it will have the value of f of omega inside this frequency. So this kind of a function, this rectangle function, which we call a low-pass filter, blocks out high frequencies if we compute this product here. This is why it's called a low-pass filter. All it lets pass are sort of the low frequencies in this range from minus omega. And so let me make that precise. We're given such a low pass filter. Then, let me see here. And then we can say, now look at this, we basically compute the inverse Fourier transform of this, which would give us a function h of x in the space domain, which again is just the inverse Fourier transform of this product of g of omega times, well, yeah, I don't know why it's this here, but let's stick with the script. F of x. So, what this equation says is we are given a function in the space domain f of x, we compute its Fourier transform. Now we are in the frequency domain, and in the frequency domain we carry out this multiplication, and then the result of this is back transformed into the space domain, and that gives us a new function in the space domain which I call h of x. So this is, I don't know why I have this intermediate step here, but maybe there is a didactic purpose, let's see later on. Of course, to me this is the same as what we just have there, is the inverse Fourier transform of g of omega times f of omega, where capital f of omega is the Fourier transform of the function f of x. Oh, yeah, this is the last one. It's basically redundant, but now, you know, why did I do it? I don't know. Probably so that we get used to this calligraphic thing, which denotes the idea of let's Fourier transform all of this. Anyway, this function, this new function h of x, will be synthesized. Synthesized from low frequency building blocks which we can think of as basis functions, these complex exponentials, basis functions only. Remember that we said if we're given a function in the space domain and we compute its Fourier transform, and that is a way of analyzing the function into its components in this basis which is given by the complex exponentials. And if we compute the inverse Fourier transform of a Fourier transform function, then that is basically to synthesize the function in terms of these basic building blocks. Now, by means of low-pass filtering, we basically block out all the high-frequency components, and so therefore, if we compute this, then we synthesize this function h of x from only those complex exponentials that correspond to low frequencies. And we have seen a couple of examples of what that does to an image. This is all just with respect to one variable, but of course this applies to functions, higher dimensional functions as well, functions defined over several variables of, let's say, multivariate functions. Applies here as well. We actually saw examples from the domain of image processing. You actually got involved with that in the exercises. You did it yourself. You saw the effect of applying these kind of filters. And not only did we discuss the low-pass filter, but also high-pass and one-pass filters. And for the high-pass filter, we could, for instance, say that if we were to do all this, then the resulting function h of x would be synthesized from high-frequency building blocks only. And we saw that the idea of high-pass filtering realized some sort of exponential, right? Now, that question, what are we actually doing if we do this? If we compute low, high bandpass filters, what do we do to functions? And to see what I'm after here, let us recall the following. Something we did a couple of weeks ago. And I want you to recall this commutative diagram for differentiation. Remember, as an introductory example into the amazing capabilities of the Fourier transform, we had a look at the problem of differentiating a function. That is, if we want to compute the derivative of some function f of x with respect to this variable x, to obtain the first derivative, which I denote as f prime of x, we saw that for certain functions, this can be realized in terms of computing the Fourier transform of the function f of x, which would give us the Fourier transform f of omega. And this f of omega might be multiplied by a factor I omega, I being the complex unit, so that we would obtain I omega f of omega. And this may be back transformed, we may compute the inverse Fourier transform to obtain the derivative. So, once again, I use this as an example for the Fourier transform being a way of simplifying certain things. Now, to compute the derivative of a function is not necessarily a difficult problem, but sometimes it can be nasty, particularly when you're dealing with the systems of coupled differential equations. And somehow, sometimes, to bypass the need of having to compute the derivative of a function directly, what we can do instead is to compute the Fourier transform first, and then instead of doing something complicated, we might be doing something simple, which is just to carry out a multiplication, which would give us a new function in the frequency domain, which if we transform it back to the space domain, would indeed produce the derivative of the function. And of course, once again, usually it is probably more difficult to go this way than to go this way directly, but sometimes this makes sense. And I wanted to recall this, or to remind ourselves of this property of the Fourier transform, because this raises the question, I raise this as well because otherwise it was silly. So, what we briefly remind ourselves of raises the question. This raises the question, probably. What do we do if we compute these filters? So, we are given a function f of x, which of course in our case are images, but let's focus on this one dimensional case of simplicity. We Fourier transform these functions to get their Fourier transform. And then in the frequency domain, we define these filter functions, low pass, high pass, band pass, you name it. And we multiply those two together to obtain space domain. Let's call it H. Now, what we just saw with respect to differentiation begs the question that if we want to filter a function to obtain a new function, and we do it like this, does there exist a direct way as well? So the questions are, is there a function g of x? We don't know yet. Is there an operation in the space domain? We don't know yet, such that this function h of x is the same as if we were to compute f of x, some operation we don't know yet, times some function g of x we don't know yet. We don't know like this. This is our problem for today. Right? With respect to differentiation, we have such a commutative diagram where we can do a, I don't know, difficult operation in terms of simpler operations by taking this detour to the frequency domain. And multiplication is a rather simple operation, isn't it? Would there be a corresponding direct way for this operation in the space domain? This is the question. Like, are there things we can fill in for all these question marks? Now, how we approach this question? Well, basically, we can try this by means of direct computation. So, but let me write down the question. So, our question is, which operation in the space domain, corresponds the operation of multiplication in the frequency domain. This is just verbalizing what we briefly discussed by means of this commutative diagram, which was not completed yet. Now, and to answer this question, let me erase it right away. Some space. Here is the answer. We consider this. And in what is to follow, I'll have to point it out. I will drop, so consider this, dropping factors of, what do we have here, 1 over square root of 2 pi. In what I'm going to do now, I will not write these things down. Okay, this is because I am lazy, and it is one of these details I told you about I really don't care about. But it is there, of course, right? And you have to be careful. I'll come back to this in, I don't know, 15 minutes. But for now, let us pretend this was 1. It's not, but I'm lazy, I will not write it down all the time. Should be there, it is not, be careful. Right? So, what we are going to consider is the product of f of omega and g of omega. Okay? Now, f of omega is obviously the minus I omega x dx. This is just another way of writing this, where again I ignore these things. They are there, but I'm not talking about them. So this is the first factor. Now then, what is the second factor? Okay, so this is some function in this in the frequency domain. We may assume that it also has a function in the Fourier inverse in the space domain. But if that is the Fourier transform of some function in the space domain, you can probably write it down. So let me do this. So this is the first factor times, and the second factor is integral from minus infinity to infinity g of x times e to the minus I omega x dx. This is, I guess, okay. This one we actually know to be the Fourier transform of something we are given. And this is something in the frequency domain, but then it may as well be the Fourier transform of something we don't know yet. But we can pretend we knew it and write it down. Okay, what I will do next is I will replace the x's with other names. I'll just, you know, instead of writing x, because we're going to multiply these two things together. And that is to say, you basically have to be careful about all these variables here. And so I'll just write it as, this is the same as the integral from minus infinity to infinity. Let's use a v here, f of v, e to the minus I omega v, dv times integral from minus infinity to infinity g of u, I'm using, yeah, e to the minus I omega u du. I only do this so that we can actually carry out this multiplication. Because these are two different things. The expressions in the parentheses, and in order to compute this product here, we have to treat them as such, and that is to say, we shouldn't use x in both cases, and this is just a subtractive substitution. Okay, we need more space, so let's create more space. So I will continue this argument on top here now. So that is to say, up until now, we are considering f of omega times g of omega, and given what we have had so far, I will write it slightly differently. Right? We have a product of two integrals. I can as well write this as a double integral. This integral from minus infinity to infinity times integral from minus to infinity. And then we have f of v times e to the minus I omega v times g of u e to the minus I omega u d v d u. This is the same, but this is the reason why I had to replace the x's by u's and v's so that we can do this. And then, of course, we realize that there are two factors in this double integral now that look rather similar. We might actually write these two complex exponentials in terms of just one complex exponential. Let's do this. So, this is the same as the integral from minus infinity to infinity, integral from minus infinity to infinity, f of v times g of u times e to the minus I omega, and now we just have g plus u g du. so far. I don't know how deep you are into integral equations, but if you are not, I can tell you that computing integrals over exponentials like that is not trivial, and so therefore we will carry out a substitution. We'll continue this in a second. This is where we are right now, but let me first introduce this substitution. So, what I am doing now is to get rid of the sum, and by sum I mean this v plus u in the exponential function, we substitute. And again, this is an informed substitution. I just set u to be some x minus v. So here is an x again. It's probably an unfortunate choice. I should have. Is this just a name? It's just a name. I can do that. And if we are given this function, u is now a function of x, then we may as well derive this function with respect to x. So then, let's look at the result. Du dx is, well, this is rather simple, this one. Second term does not depend on x, first one does. And now if I multiply both sides of this equation with a dx, we find that du is the same as dx. Okay, just did that so that you are with me in the next step. Now then, with what we just considered to be a good idea, if we make use of it, we find that f of omega times g of omega, these product between two Fourier transforms, can be expressed as the infinity to infinity. And where there was a u in the previous step, I will now replace all the u's with x minus v. So we have v of x minus v, and here we have e to the minus I omega x. Okay, that is according to our substitution. Dv, and here we see that this is just an x. Make that explicit previously. Okay, so this is where we are right now, and this is beginning to look familiar again. I will rearrange these things once more. So we are given the integral from minus infinity to infinity, and then we have integral from minus infinity f of v g of u minus x minus v x minus v. I have to be careful with all these substitutions. this looks suspiciously like a Fourier transform, right? We have an integral over some function times e to the minus I omega x dx. And so this is indeed a Fourier transform. And once more, last time I said, recall that I have dropped these 1 over 2 pi square root of pi things. They are there, but I don't want to write them down. This is a Fourier transform. Which is to say that this product of two Fourier transforms is itself the Fourier transform of another function. Right. Let me make that explicit. Boy, does this function look ugly. Right. This is similar to the case of when I said, hey, we have uncovered the Fourier coefficient as an integral, and why was I so happy about that? And this is probably the same situation here. We have uncovered that what we are after is nothing else but another Fourier transform, but obviously it is the Fourier transform of something ugly. And still, I am tremendously happy with this result. Are you already happy as well? Have you seen this before? Yes. Okay. We'll discuss this in a second. Boy, is this an ugly function? Another integral. So, but in other words, this product of two Fourier transforms, where one is the Fourier transform of something we know, and the other is the Fourier transform of something we don't know yet, this product is the same as the Fourier transform of this function, integral from minus infinity to infinity, f of v times g of x minus v, v, v. That is what we call. We have established that this product is the Fourier transform, which is good. We're looking for space domain equivalent of this, and if this is just another Fourier transform, then that is to say there must be something in the space domain that corresponds to this product. And
what's that?
It's one beautiful question. However, we're done, right? So we have found our answer. This is our answer. But this is another ugly answer. In the same sense as when we once again studied Fourier coefficients, and we found that the Fourier coefficient is an integral, and I was happy, and you might be wondering why I was so happy about this crazy integral we uncovered, because that integral was an inner product. I was happy with that. Once we looked into what it meant to be an inner product, we all were happy, I hope. Now we have this. I'm already very happy, and I don't know if you are happy yet, but let me tell you that this thing here, even if it's like really happiness, is, I don't like it. Still, it makes me happy, because this thing is one of the, I don't know, should be very careful if I say this, most important operations in mathematics. Careful here, but let us define something, namely the convolution of two functions, f of x and g of x, and we are still talking about the one-dimensional case here, is given by, so I am defining the operation of convolution, and this I will write as f star g. This this is like that. This is a definition. Like this, and I could have started with this definition, and then we could have looked into our problem, and we would have realized that after a couple of algebraic manipulations, we found something that is well known in that plan. So, indeed, what we have found is that the product of two Fourier transforms is the Fourier transform of a convolution. And I will talk about convolutions in a second. But let us first sort of put it all together to finally answer our question and then get back to these convolutions. Filters we are interested in the space domain. So this is what we have uncovered. That indeed, for this somewhat apparently cumbersome operation of having to transform a function f of x, and then having to define some filter function g of omega, and then multiplying the Fourier transform of f of omega with g of omega, and then computing the inverse Fourier transform. Instead of doing all of this, we may just as well do this, where we have to define a suitable space domain function g of x, something next time, but it is indeed possible to compute this filtering without going to the frequency domain. We can do it in the space domain directly. Right? And this is so important. This is a major result. And I will therefore write it down once more. This is known as the convolution theorem. So the convolution theorem says that the Fourier transform of a convolution is the Fourier transform of the first function times the Fourier transform of the second function, and then there is a constant in front of it. This is the 2 pi things which I didn't care about. Okay. So it is there. Let me get this out. This is a constant of multiplication, which is too much of a detail for me. actually important because of the sort of opposite problem than what we studied here. What we studied today was, well, we are given this idea of filtering the frequency domain. Is there an equivalent in the space domain? And we saw there is, and this theorem establishes that. Right? So, indeed, if we want to compute this, the convolution of two functions, we may as well do it like that. And this is actually the importance of the theorem, that we can, instead of doing this, we can do this. Funnily enough, today we were sort of studying the opposite question. Instead of doing this, can we do something else? Yes, we can. This might be difficult. Right? And so therefore, this is another instance of fact that sometimes we may reduce difficult operations to simpler ones. Right? Of course, this always involves computing Fourier transforms and Fourier inverse transforms, which is something nasty, but in the exercise you've already seen that, like, practically you don't have to worry about this because there are powerful software libraries that do that for you. Okay? So the importance of the theorem is actually to say that we can replace this like so, even though we were coming from the opposite direction. Now, let's ever so briefly, like, why am I so happy with the fact that this is this? Why would I consider this to be a satisfactory discovery? And ever so briefly, I thought I'd point out the significance of convolutions. So, and that is, like, the significance is basically to say that convolutions, I won't write it in its own splendor, occur everywhere. Everywhere. The fact that this crazy integral has a name is already giving it away, right? I said everything that is important has a name. And this funny integral from minus infinity to infinity f of b times g of x minus v dv, this crazy integral has a name. It's called the convolution of f of g. It has a name, it is important, they occur everywhere. For instance, in probability theory, we have that the sum of two independent random variables. So those of you who have been with me earlier know that r dot v dot is a shorthand for random variable. So two probabilistic objects. The sum of two independent random variables is distributed as the convolution of the two individual distributions. So this is already, it's probably in addition to its use in signal processing, the most significant property or use case for this operation of convolution. You're given two random variables, I don't know, whatever. Throwing dice two times should be independent both times, and you're interested in what is the sum of the first and the second roll of the dice, and this value of the sum of the first and the second roll will be distributed as the convolution of the distribution of obtaining a certain number in the first row and obtaining a certain number in the second. So it's really, really incredibly important concept in probability theory. And I said everywhere, just another funny use case is that the product of polynomials, so you give the function, I don't know, a naught plus a1 times x plus a2 times x squared plus a3 times x cubed, and you're given another function b0 plus b1 times x plus b2 times x squared. And so it's the two polynomials, you want to multiply them together. It turns out multiplication of these two polynomials is a convolution of the two individual equations, formulas. And so on and so forth. This is really, this integral is incredibly ugly to look at. I concede that, but it is incredibly important at the same time. And let's ever so briefly look into a couple of properties of these convolutions. And then we will look at convolutions of functions of two variables and discrete convolutions. Now, but to just expose you to it, convolutions have the following properties. So they are commutative, and that is to say that the convolution of f and g is the same as the convolution of g and f. They are associative, which is to say that the convolution of f with the convolution of g and h is the same as the convolution of f and g convolved with h. They are distributive, which is to say that the convolution of f with g plus h is the same as the convolution of f and g plus the convolution of f and h. And then they have this scalar multiplication property, by which I mean that if we look at I make it a times the convolution of f and g, then that is the same as, say, a times f convolved with g, and of course also the same as f convolved with a times g. I don't write that down. So these are basic properties, and the last two here indicate that, remember when we talked about linear operations, really linear transformations, and I said that an operation is linear if it has these two properties, well, convolutions have them. Right? So this is to say that convolutions are also linear operators. Okay, I have two more. Actually, it's three more. You know, without further discussion, that's just, you can actually probably verify it at home. I don't know. you now know how this is defined, and you can actually verify it. All of this is given. And you should find yesterday. If you want to verify that at home, I have a couple more. Yeah, I'll start with this one. fitting these Fourier transforms, we are dealing with these complex valued exponential functions. So we are, by now well used to the fact that we can compute with complex values and complex valued functions. And so therefore I point out this one. If we look at the complex conjugate of the convolution of, say, two complex valued functions, then that is the same as if we were to convolve the two complex conjugates. I'm just saying, I don't think we actually ever need this. It's good to know, right? Here is something that is definitely worth knowing. Namely, there exists an identity element. This thing is called delta. I'll make it like so, delta of x. And being an identity element, it has the following property that if we compute the convolution of f of x with this delta of x, we basically obtain the function f of x again. I am saying this at this point. It will come back next week when we do a bit of theory. But if you read the literature of all this, right, if you read books at home or stuff on the web, something about convolutions, you will come across this one, delta of x. I have not specified it yet. I am only saying that it exists. There is such a function, such that if we convolve it with any function, we get this function. So this is the identity. It does nothing with respect to convolution. You will find this in all the literature. And the way it is introduced there is typically, it drives me crazy. It makes me mad. And so I will come back to this next week. The reason why you need to know about this actually, we are not really going to make a lot of use of it, but in general, this is very important if you want to verify certain properties of equations that involve convolutions. So it's good to know that it is there in the literature, in the books. I recommend it for further reading. You will come across it and then use it to prove certain properties of convolutions, blah, blah, blah. So now you know it is there. We don't know yet how it looks like. We'll come back to that later. It is there. And then finally, here is a funny one. And I will come back to that later again. The last one is actually one you are going to have to use in one of the exercises. So, it is rather easy to show that if you are interested in the derivative of the convolution of two functions, then that is the same as the derivative of one of the functions convolved with the other, and it does not really make a big difference which of the two functions you derive first. So this is something, again, I will not show you. It is rather, again, easy to verify at home, but you will have to use that in the second or third project ever. In one of the projects, I'm asking you to compute a certain convolution, and I say make use of this, so now you know that it exists. I'm not going to prove that. Right. Okay. this is all good and well. This was convolution by means of the example of univariate functions, functions depending on one variable. We can generalize that. I'm just saying, without going into the details, now if we are given two functions f and g, and we do want to convolve them, and they are now two-dimensional functions, well, that does exist. It's just the integral from minus infinity, integral from minus infinity, f, yeah, well, now it happens. Okay, psi eta times g of x minus psi comma y minus eta d psi d eta. I have been, I don't know why I have to, try to avoid the use of these two additional Greek letters here. This one is called psi. This is sort of the Greek equivalent for x. It looks crazy, and I don't like to write it. It is on the slides. So on the slides, there are no u's and v's, because typically in the literature, people don't use u's. I have been using u's and v's to avoid these things, and now then I did, I don't know why. It's my fault. And the other one is called eta. This is sort of, yeah, it's a mixture of e and I. And it looks a bit like a Y, so this is why I'm using that one. I should not have done this. It happened anyway. But this are again just symbols, right? Symbols from the Greek alphabet. I am using those on the slides though, right? Because there they look nicer. When I write them down, they don't look so nice. But most of the textbooks you will read probably use these Greek letters. So, right? Okay, so this is the two-dimensional convolution, whereas we had just one integration in the case of one-dimensional functions. We now have integration with respect to two variables. This is straightforward generalization, just as we generalized the Fourier transform from 1D to 2D. And now, the thing that is really of importance to us in image processing, and the thing that will make all of this immediately clear, right? I will now go for the discrete 2D convolution. And then we can finally appreciate the meaning of these horrible, horrible, horrible things here. So, I will put a discrete in front of this. Discrete. Now, when we do image processing, right, we already agreed that we can think of images as discrete functions. And of course, these functions are defined over two variables because they have an x and y direction, such images. So let's look at the discrete equivalent of these horrible integral expressions. So if f and g are two discrete functions, which, if you remember, I indicate by square brackets instead of parentheses, then instead of this integral, we of course have summation, right? No integrals, but summation. And these summations look like this. We have a summation index I, which ranges from, say, minus n over 2 to some m over 2, and an index j, which ranges from n over 2, minus n to n over 2. Right? So there are minuses in front of here, and no minuses up there. And then we have f at x minus I and y minus j times g at m over 2 minus I and m over 2 minus j. Okay. Now, this is indeed but it is the discrete equivalent of what we just said. And what this means is best explained, a picture says 1,000 words, like actually 10,000 in this case, I guess. So here is a picture. Now, I will first draw a function f, and all we have to know right now that these functions are also matrices. So I can draw this, and I will call this here f. This is, say, a beautiful digital image. Okay? And then, what color do I use? Okay, I'm using blue. I know that the green is not visible on camera, but blue is not so different from black, but there is no red anywhere. So, what are we doing? So then, I'll draw something like this, a sub-image, so to say, and I will call this one G. So the larger thing is called F, and the smaller thing is called G. And this f has an extension of capital M pixels along the x direction and capital N pixels along the y direction. And this smaller thing G here has an extension of lowercase m pixels, say, along the x direction. Can you see there is a lowercase m in blue? It's this m here. And it has an extension of lowercase n pixels along the y direction. And then finally, I make it green anyway, but I hope it's visible on camera. This thing here, this pixel, sort of the center of this small, let's call it window, G, or small patch G, this here, this pixel, has a coordinate Y, and here is the X coordinate. Now we have everything that occurs in this equation. Actually, we even have more n, capital N. But let's look at what this means, given this picture. So we have a summation that ranges over two dimensions. Okay. And it goes from minus n over 2 to n over 2 and minus n over 2 to n over 2. Now I said m and n are these things. So in our case it's both 3 and 3. And let's say that integer division m over 2, that is 1. So basically this would go from minus 1, 0, 1. And this would go from, in our example here, minus 1, 0 to 1. Right, this is in this case, both I and J range from minus 1 to 1 because we understand this as integer division here. And so we apparently have something that sums over all the elements here in this G. Where I am referring to these elements, this one here, with respect to this 3x3 window G, would be the zero coordinate of G. And so then this one would be, I don't know, minus 1 and minus 1 coordinate. This is minus 1 to the left hand side, no zeros up here, minus 1 up. Right? And this one would be the 1, 1 coordinate of G. So if we compute this summation here, and you see this, m over 2 I said is 1, it goes from minus 1 to 1, then what this means is, if we compute this, we are interested in producing a new function. So this one here is called h of x and y. In this new function, which of course will be another thing like this, something new. In this new function, the pixel at this location will have a value where we take this element of the blue window and multiply it with the underlying element of the larger matrix function. Right? That is, we multiply this element of G with the corresponding underlying element of F. To that, we add the product of this element of G with the underlying element of F, and so on and so forth. So the value of this new function that results from convolving these two things, this new function, at this place, x and y, we are currently considering, results from summing over all the products of the elements in G with the corresponding underlying elements in F. And if we want to compute this convolution at the next pixel in H, we have to move this G one to the right and do it again, and so on and so forth. If we want to do it in the next row, we have to move this here. This is, again, the picture says 1,000 words. This is what this equation says. This is convolution. And it is, in fact, basically the same with these integrals. With these integrals, we don't have these discrete cells. We cannot really talk about it. So like, the discrete convolution is actually really easy to understand if we look at this picture. Now, and this picture is already really close to what we are doing in image processing when we make use of convolution. Note that this G is much smaller than this F. With respect to the integrals we met earlier, there was no difference. They were both like sort of the same size. And of course, in general, for the discrete case, we could do this as well. Then I would have to have lots of infinities here again, but summing over something infinitive is not really practical. So what we think about when we use convolution in image processing is that there is a, let's call it a convolution mask, or call it a convolution mask. G is a convolution mask. Some small rectangle of values, a small function, a small discrete function. And we have F, the image we are given. We want to convolve F and G is something smaller than F in practice. Right? Then what we do is, we compute this new image H by moving this function, or this mask, G, over all the pixels in F, computing this double sum at every location, and the result of this double sum will then be the new value in this new image H. So this is all there is to it. There's of course a practical caveat, right? How would we compute the value here? where if we were to place this G, it would look like so. How would you do that? Funnily enough, you have to do it in the exercise. Yeah, so anybody here? That's one idea. So she suggested to periodically repeat the picture. Yes, that can be done. Because I mean, this cannot be computed, right? If like, now let's be computer scientists and say, okay, this is a 2D array. The larger thing is a 2D array. I'm just sliding one 2D array over a larger 2D array, and we compute at every location, compute this double sum to get the value in the resulting larger array. Then I cannot do this at this location. Actually, I cannot do this at any location around the boundary or borders of the image. And depending on the size of G, I cannot even do this here, right? So it's not just this, it's just I single out one. We cannot do this in practice at the boundary of the image. And there are, and there's, seriously, this is something, there's nothing we can do about. The things you can do are dirty tricks. One dirty trick is to say, okay, let's sort of, you know, copy these things up to here and these in here. Let's enlarge the image sort of periodically so that it becomes large enough such that we can do it. And of course, we would not have to compute this convolution up here, but we would confine ourselves to the original image extent. Then it can be done. Another way of addressing this problem in practice is to say that, well, let's pad the image. It's called pad it with lots of zeros. So there are lots of zeros surrounding this thing here. Right? This is called padding. I'll write it down here. Padding. And the last one is, I'll find it up here, picture. The last one is to ignore the boundary. That is to say, in practice, nobody cares about what's going on in a sort of like 5 pixels of the boundary. Right? We just don't compute that there. Which is to say that in the resulting H, so make it here, basically this is all, say, zero. Due to the fact that we never put this convolution mask at pixels where it would extend beyond the original, which we just computed for pixels where, depending on its size, it fits. And for those pixels, we ignore when we do this, which is set them to zero. Yeah, this is. I am just saying that the sci-fi library, for instance, in Python sci-fi library, provides functions for convolution, for a discrete convolution in the space domain. So this is discrete convolution, right? We are given something, we can think of this G as the space domain representation of our low-pass filter, say. We have not looked into how it may look like in the next time. But this is the space domain representation of this function g of omega, which was the low band high pass filter we discussed last time. So we can do this in the space domain. And in order to compute this filtering in the space domain, we have to move this mask across the image and get new values. Right? We'll discuss that next time. If you want to do that in Python with SciPy, it offers you functions to do so, and it asks you how to deal with the boundary. There are parameters where you can say basically ignore boundary pixels. I don't know how this thing, look it up on the manuals. But it offers you to do this, so that is basically to convolve the image with the filter mask, ignoring the boundary pixels, one option. Another option is this padding with zeros. I don't know how it's called there, but it is there. And actually, I guess this periodic continuation is also an option. And there might be more. You can actually choose that. Right? So if you use those functions, then they allow you, I don't know what the default is, but they allow you to specify how to handle these boundary cases. And the very unsatisfactory thing is, there is really no principled way of handling that. This is where all of this all of a sudden becomes a craft rather than a science. This is an artifact of dealing with digital images, which are of finite extension and discrete. And you could say, okay, well, then we don't have to do this, because we can obviously sort of transform the image into the frequency domain and transform this filter to the frequency domain and do it there. But remember last time I also discussed that even if you were to compute the Fourier transform, you can get certain artifacts because of, again, boundary conditions. So there is no way around that. This is something that is just there. This is something that is just there. And depending on what you choose to do, your results in the first couple of rows, last couple of rows, first couple of columns, last couple of columns, again, that depends on the size of your filter mask, it will look different. But of course, once you reach sort of the part of the image that is not suffering from this boundary problem, it doesn't make sense. And this is one of the things nobody writes about when they, I don't know, there's some new breakthrough in we do something with images, we write a scientific paper, and in order to obtain this result, we first convolve the image with something. Nobody says what they did at the boundaries. This is typically a wrong handling. Some way of handling that. So, all right. Time is almost up. So. I have brought a live Python notebook in which I demonstrate something we discussed in the exercise. Maybe the avoidance of for loops in image processing if we are using Python. It's not worth starting that now. I have already uploaded that to the course page. It's an HTML file, so it is under the lecture notes section of the course page, and it's an HTML file, so you sort of just have to click on it and open it with your browser. An IPython notebook that discusses how to avoid for loops. I will see if I can do it quickly next time we meet. It's not no big deal. Do it then. It's not worth it. Please start it now. And then next time we are going to look into the question, well, how do these lowercase g things look like? Right? We have not talked about this yet. I just said they are there, and we have not thought about how to choose this function g such that it makes sense in, say, filtering or, say, noise removal. This is something we're going to study next time. I would very much encourage you, so this is probably, given all we have done today, is really the most important whiteboard, and everything is here. So these functions G are called convolution maps. This is convention. We assume that F is the image we are dealing with, and then we have some volume which typically thought to be smaller, so that we have finite summations here. It could be of infinite size, but then this would be impractical. Right? So we think that G is something small, which we slide over the image, compute this double summation, get a new image. If you can wrap your heads around this whiteboard and actually verify that this is the same as sliding something over the image, because this year x and y changes, right? For each x and y, the header is like that. If you can wrap your head around this, then you have understood the most important aspect of image processing. It's like that. This is by far one of the most important operations we can do with images. So look at this once again at home. Let's say that was all for today, because this doesn't make sense to start right now. Are there any questions? No questions. Yeah, you have. Never choose to leave. A very, very excellent question. Thank you very much. She said, in this example, we have a center point of G because we chose M and N to be odd numbers. What if they were even? Never use even numbers. That is the answer to that. Right? Seriously. Never do that. It can be done with even numbers as well, but avoid, you know, this, you see, there are nasty problems, right? And certain problems we cannot really totally avoid, but this problem of the non-existence of a center point, we can avoid by choosing these N and M to be odd. And then we're good. So, excellent question, I forgot to say that, always choose lowercase n and lowercase m to be odd. 3, 5, 7, 9, 11, right? And then nobody, seriously, nobody in practice, I'm not aware of that. Anybody would ever choose 2, 4, whatever. There was another question. Yeah?
There's a formula about the relative also,
yeah.
Right
partial dispersion? Yes and no. So, first of all, basically no. Right? Because we don't have... So, okay, her question was, does this formula with respect to the properties of the convolution regarding derivatives also apply for the discrete case? And the answer is yes and no. No, because we do not have this kind of a derivative for the discrete case. And so therefore, basically, like in the perfect mathematical sense, no, it does not, but yes, it does, because, you know, we can just pretend it would hold. And this is to say, for instance, if we... Oh, again, very nice question. Now that we're discussing it, in these exercises, I want you to compute the derivative of that, right? And I say, do it by deriving this and convolve the image with the derivative of g. Now, you know, we can pretend that you can compute the derivative of g, even though it's discrete. Right? At the very, very bottom, no, this would be not entirely correct mathematically. But in is something like, we choose this to be odd, we do something at the boundary, we pretend we get a bit of what can I say? More questions like this, please, because these are exactly the things nobody talks about in public, but everybody does anyway. So no, like, in the very rigorous sense, no, we cannot do this, but we do it anyway. Any other questions? Okay.